Hi, my name is Nick Ballas, and I'd like to introduce you to an exciting new advance in jewelry casting technology. This NewTek J2R is a new generation of affordable, resistance-heated vacuum casting machines. The NewTek J2R offers a small to medium-sized production facility, cost-effective, high-quality casting with clean, safe casting cycles. The J2R employs the proven principles of closed system casting, which provides an oxygen-free atmosphere during melting and pouring of the metal to minimize oxidation and contamination. The J2R's closed system is comprised of two separate chambers, which are sealed during casting and flooded with an inert gas, such as nitrogen or argon. The isolation between the two chambers allows for the inert atmosphere during melting in the top chamber, while flask-changing activity occurs in the lower chamber. Then, once the lower chamber is closed and a vacuum is applied to the flask, inert gas is introduced around the top portion of the mold, preserving the oxygen-free atmosphere where the molten metal will leave the crucible and enter the mold cavity. Keeping the hot metal free of oxygen is only part of the equation for successful casting. Another important factor is good control of the metal temperature. By having the temperature-sensing thermocouple at the center of the metal pool, the J2R has accurate measurement of the heating event, allowing you to cast truly close to the preset temperature. The bottom pour crucible design reduces metal turbulence, delivering the cleanest metal to the mold interior, and because of the short pouring distance, results in very little temperature drop in the metal. This means that the metal can be cast at the lowest possible temperature, thereby reducing brittleness, shrinkage porosity, and the potential for sulfur dioxide porosity. In addition to the inert gas atmosphere, the J2R incorporates a graphite crucible. The graphite in the crucible provides a reduction atmosphere for the hot metal, removing oxygen that may have been previously dissolved in it. Jewelry items vary in size and complexity. By taking advantage of the J2R's repeatability and accurate temperature control, it is possible with a little experimentation to arrive at the best possible casting temperature for any type of item, whether it's filigree or flat. Once you've determined the optimum temperature, you can be sure that the J2R will repeat it time after time. The J2R produces consistent melting cast cycles for most jewelry alloys and will accept up to 100 by 255 millimeter or 4 by 9 inch flask. After the initial heat up of the crucible, which takes about 40 minutes, complete casting cycles in the J2R range from 6 to 8 minutes, depending on the size of the metal load. These essential attributes of speed and repeatability will benefit any casting operation by increasing productivity and reducing waste. The J2R is user-friendly and requires very little training to operate successfully. In this part of the video, we will show you how the J2R is set up and operated. If you've just received a new J2R, this section of the video can be used as a supplement to the operation manual that comes with the machine. Check the manual to see that you've received all of the parts needed to hook up the J2R. In addition to the crucible parts and supply hoses included with the machine, you'll need a 5 CFM vacuum pump and a tank of technical grade nitrogen or argon with an appropriate regulator. Be sure to specify nitrogen that does not contain oxygen and do not use any combustible, corrosive, or poisonous gas in the J2R. For electrical hookup, the J2R requires a dedicated 220-volt, single-phase, 15-amp circuit. The J2R will need to be placed in a location that has at least 12 inches of clearance around the machine, and it must be level. Leveling feet are provided, which install in threaded holes on the bottom of the machine after it's removed from the shipping crate. To make the J2R operational, you'll need to attach the inert gas and vacuum pump hookups, as well as install the complete crucible assembly. Since most of the crucible parts are expendable and require periodic replacement, the following procedures will provide you with the knowledge to perform necessary maintenance later on.
Using one of the larger hose clamps and the larger of the two supplied hoses, attach the half-inch vacuum hose to the fitting at the vacuum control valve near the lower left side of the flask chamber. Be sure your vacuum pump outlet has a hose nipple fitting compatible with the half-inch hose, and attach the other end to the pump. If the pump has not been filled with oil, do this now, and check periodically to make sure it doesn't run low. Next, attach the brass inert gas fitting to the port, located on the right side of the machine. Tighten the base nut of the fitting with a wrench. Remove the outside nut from the fitting and slide it onto one end of the gas hose. Push the hose onto the fitting nipple as far as it will go, and then secure it with the compression nut. Attach the other end of the hose to the inert gas regulator, equipped with a 1/4-inch barb fitting.
Now we're ready to put the crucible assembly together. When you replace any of these parts later on, it's preferable to work on a cold machine. If you have to replace a crucible part on a hot machine, remember that the parts are very hot and will require caution not to cause a severe burn. Don't set parts down where they can start a fire, or you or someone else will bump into them. Also, be certain the machine is turned off or disconnected from the electrical supply while you perform these procedures. To put crucible parts in, you need to remove the crucible chamber hood. If this were a replacement procedure, you would first need to unplug the thermocouple from the machine body.
The hood is held in place by ball bearings under spring pressure with detents in each hood tab. The pressure of these bearings can be adjusted if the hood seems too tight or too loose under the brackets. To remove the hood, simply rotate it counterclockwise until the tabs are clear and carefully lift it straight up off the machine. As you can see, we are looking at the heating coil assembly into which the 4 crucible parts will be installed. This assembly has been designed to give thousands of hours of service with normal use. After using the machine a few times, you may notice some cracking of the ceramic muffle. This is normal and won't affect the machine's operation. Be sure the bottom of the chamber is clean and free of debris. To assemble the crucible parts, first place the ceramic crucible stand on the melting chamber floor with the funnel protrusion down so the flat side faces up. Next, put the black lower crucible gasket on top of the crucible stand. Be sure it fits down inside of the crucible stand rim. Do not leave this part out. This gasket helps protect the crucible from deterioration and must be replaced when it begins to lose its black color. Wipe the crucible with a paper towel, inside and out, and check the pour hole to be sure there are no imperfections or obstructions. Set the crucible on the gasket in the chamber and check for centering. Place the large ceramic filling cone disc over the top of the crucible.
If this were a maintenance replacement of the crucible, you'd want to check the sealing rod ball for wear and replace it if necessary. If you're doing the initial setup, the new sealing rod and ball are already assembled, but we'll show you how to replace the ball on the sealing rod in just a minute. This ball must fit properly in the bottom of the crucible in order to maintain a good seal. An imperfection in the fit will allow liquid metal to escape. The sealing ball will need replacing more often than other parts, so you may want to keep some extra ball and rod assemblies on hand for quick replacement.
The ball is held onto the rod with IZ100 high heat cement. Before mixing the cement, try the ball on the rod end to make sure the fit is good. This cement contains silica, so use precautions to avoid breathing the powder or getting it into your eyes. Mix a small amount of cement at a ratio of approximately 5 parts powder to 1 part water by volume, or 7 to 1 by weight. At first, the mixture may appear dry, but do not add extra water. This will only make the cement weak and will not result in a good bond. Continue to mix until the cement is smooth. Wet the end of the sealing rod with water to prevent too rapid drying of the cement. Apply cement to the outside of the rod end, making sure none gets on the end of the rod or inside the hole. Cement inside the rod or ball will cause the thermocouple not to seat properly and will result in incorrect temperature readings. Push the ball on the rod and twist to get a good seal. Use a little extra cement to fillet the joint between the ball and the rod so molten metal will not collect there. Allow the cement to set for at least 20 minutes before installing the rod. The cement will set faster and stronger at 180 Fahrenheit or 82 Celsius.
We're now ready to install the sealing rod into the hood. The sealing rod is held in place by a clamp inside the hood. This clamp is at the end of a steel tube connected to the lifting lever on the outside of the hood. The lifting lever raises the steel tube and sealing rod, releasing metal into the mold once it's ready for casting. Adjusting the sealing rod for proper contact with the crucible is done by loosening the adjusting knob on the top of the hood and sliding the steel tube, which holds the rod. Whenever you remove the hood for maintenance, this steel tube should be pulled to its uppermost position so the ball won't get crushed when replacing the hood.
To install or replace the sealing rod assembly, loosen the adjusting knob on top of the hood and pull the entire sealing rod assembly down and out of the hood. Loosen the Allen head set screw on the clamp holding the sealing rod with a 5mm Allen wrench. If there is already a rod in place, this will allow you to remove it and insert a new one into the clamp. Push the rod into the clamp as far as it will go. Tighten the clamp with the Allen wrench.
This clamp must be fairly tight since it's subject to high heat and will expand. If it's not tight enough, the sealing rod can slip out of the clamp when you attempt to cast. If this happens, the metal will not be released or will only be partially released.
Adjacent and parallel to the sealing rod assembly, inside the hood, is the carbon stirring rod used to stir the hot metal. If it is not installed or needs replacement, you would do this now. The stirring rod is held in place with a clamp, also requiring a 5mm Allen wrench. This clamp assembly does not come out of the hood. Open the glass access door, loosen the clamp, insert the new stirring rod, and tighten the clamp. To install the sealing rod assembly, insert the metal tube end up through the top of the hood.
The tube must go through the adjusting knob collar, which is normally aligned in the U-bracket at the end of the release lever.
Push it up as far as it will go and then turn it so the Allen head clamp screw faces the window. Tighten the adjusting knob to hold it in place while you put the hood back on.
You're now ready to replace the hood, adjust the sealing rod tension, and install the thermocouple. Be sure the sealing rod assembly is all the way up so it won't crush on the bottom of the crucible when you set the hood on. Proper adjustment of the sealing ball in the crucible is critical in preventing leakage of the molten metal.
Replace the hood by carefully lowering it straight down onto the top of the crucible chamber. Rotate the hood clockwise so the lugs align in position under the brackets. Be sure the small locking lever is pulled back in the unlocked position. This small lever locks the sealing rod assembly in the up position when the machine is not in use. Next, loosen the sealing rod adjusting knob and push down on the steel tube. This will move the assembly down, firmly seating the sealing ball in the bottom of the crucible. Holding the steel tube down with one hand, squeeze the casting lever until there is about a 5mm or 3/16 inch gap between the hood flange and the stirring assembly bushing. Making sure the steel tube doesn't move, tighten the sealing rod adjusting knob. This gap between the flange and the stirring assembly bushing allows the spring tension of the casting lever to provide downward pressure on the sealing rod and ball. Using the adjusting knob as a handle, rotate the sealing rod assembly back and forth 3 or 4 times to make a new seat between the ball and the crucible. Recheck the gap. If it has lessened, loosen the adjusting knob again, reset the gap, and retighten the adjusting knob.
You're now ready to install the thermocouple. The J2R is equipped with a special nickel-chromium thermocouple, which is compatible with the J2R's temperature controller. Because of the expansion and contraction caused by constant heating and cooling, the thermocouple will occasionally wear out, requiring replacement. Use caution when replacing the thermocouple on a hot machine, since it will be as hot as the crucible. Insert the thermocouple into the top of the steel tube holding the sealing rod and push it to the bottom until it stops. It must be all the way down and seated in the ball at the end of the sealing rod for accurate temperature control to occur. Connect the thermocouple wires to the terminal block mounted next to the sealing rod assembly. Be sure the wire colors match the colors in the block, green to green and white to white. If the wires are crossed, the controller will show the temperature going down when it's actually going up. Now plug the lead wire connector from the terminal block into the small socket next to the controller panel. We're now ready to start casting with the J2R. We'll begin by getting acquainted with the temperature controller. At this point, you can plug in and switch the machine on with the on-off switch located in the lower right corner of the machine. Your J2R controller has been pre-programmed at NewTek to operate well with most jewelry alloys. Under normal circumstances, all you need to do is set the casting temperature for the alloy you're using. Keep in mind that there are many variables affecting the ideal temperature for any particular casting. These include the mold temperature, how the sprueing is designed, and the shape and detail of the items to be cast.
When the controller lights up, the current crucible temperature is displayed on the upper row of lights. The lower row indicates whatever set point temperature was last entered into the controller. At this time, the melting chamber will begin to heat. If you want to stop the chamber from heating without turning the machine off, simply unplug the thermocouple connector from the machine. When you do this, the upper row of lights will indicate a series of small U's, and power will be turned off to the melting chamber. To set a new casting temperature, press the up or down arrow buttons on the lower right portion of the controller panel until the desired temperature is indicated in the lower row. The button marked SEL and the blank leftmost button are used for programming.
Initially, it'll take the machine about 40 minutes to reach the set temperature. Once you start the heating cycle, you should see a slow, even rise in temperature. If this doesn't happen or something seems wrong with the controller, check to be sure the thermocouple is all the way down inside the sealing rod. If this does not solve the problem, consult the operating manual to reset the controller with the NewTek factory program. Additionally, the controller can be programmed to indicate the temperature in either Celsius or Fahrenheit. This programming feature is described in your operation manual. If you'll be using the machine in the Celsius mode, be sure to remove the F sticker from the upper right-hand corner of the controller panel, which will reveal the C indication.
Once you are sure the thermocouple and controller are operating normally and you have set the casting temperature, you can turn on the inert gas. Set the tank regulator to about 10 psi or 0.7 bar and then adjust the gas flow to 4 liters per minute. The machine is designed to be used with casting grain. Do not use large pieces of metal which could displace the sealing rod. Also, the correct amount of metal is important. If you use too much metal, the flask will overflow and you may have to loosen the chamber positioning collar so that it can be dropped down in order to get the flask out. When the temperature is within about 50 degrees Fahrenheit or 10 Celsius of the set temperature, open the hood window and charge the crucible with the correct amount of metal for the flask you'll be casting.
After you add the metal, the controller will indicate a rapid drop of 300 to 500 degrees Fahrenheit as the new metal cools the chamber. The temperature will then begin a steady climb to just below the melting temperature of the alloy, where it will slow down. The transition in the metal from a solid to a liquid requires a great deal of heat energy. This is called the heat of transformation. Once the alloy becomes liquid, the temperature will again rise rapidly. The program in the controller will turn the heat off about 20 degrees Fahrenheit below the casting set point. Because of the residual heat in the coil, the temperature will continue to rise past the set point. Do not cast while the temperature is rising. Wait for it to peak and then drop back down to the desired temperature before casting.
As the temperature moves up, approaching the set point, be sure the vacuum valve is closed and then turn on the vacuum pump. Release the lower flask chamber by moving the locking lever all the way to the left. Use the flask chamber handle on the right side of the chamber to swing the chamber out. Be sure the correct flask adapter plate is used in the top of the flask chamber. These O-ring adapters and matching gaskets are available for flasks from 2.5 to 4 inches. Place the correct high heat woven gasket on top of the adapter to provide a positive seal for the flask. Remove the flask from the burnout oven and place it into the flask chamber. Be sure the underside of the flask collar, where it comes in contact with the gasket seal, is free of investment. Open the vacuum lever. The gauge should indicate a vacuum being drawn on the flask. If it does not, rotate the flask with the tongs to get it to seat properly. Or, if the woven gasket or the O-ring adapter seems damaged, replace it. Once you get a good vacuum indication, swing the flask chamber back under the melting chamber and secure it up by moving the locking lever to the right. Time this step so that the chamber is in position 30 seconds prior to casting. This will ensure that any air in the mold is replaced by inert gas. The metal temperature will go above the set casting temperature and then begin to drop back down. Wait for the metal temperature to come back down to the set point before casting. Just prior to casting, rotate the stirring rod lever back and forth several times to stir the metal, and then squeeze the release handle for 3 seconds. This lifts the sealing rod and allows the metal to flow into the flask. Release the handle, which closes the bottom of the crucible with the sealing ball, and rotate the sealing rod adjusting knob several times to reseat the ball in preparation for the next cast.
After casting, you'll need to let the flask cool for about 45 seconds with the vacuum still on. After 45 seconds or so, lower the flask chamber by moving the locking lever to the left and rotate the chamber out. Close the vacuum and remove the cast flask. Set it aside to cool until the button loses its color before quenching. If you're done casting, you can shut down the vacuum system. First, open the valve to depressurize the lines, and then shut off the vacuum pump. This way, oil from the pump will not be drawn into the line. If you'll be casting more flasks, now would be the time to charge the crucible with new metal. If you're done, lock the release handle in the up position with the locking lever. This way, the sealing ball won't stick to the bottom of the crucible as the chamber cools. Next, lower the set point temperature to below room temperature and leave the inert gas on until the temperature reads about 600 degrees Fahrenheit or the crucible turns a dark gray. When you cast different alloys, it's advisable to switch the crucible for each alloy. Plan your casting routine so that the flasks for each alloy are grouped together. When changing a crucible while the machine is hot, first turn off the machine and then raise the sealing rod and lock it in the up position, while you let the crucible cool to about 600 degrees Fahrenheit or 300 degrees Celsius. Always be sure to readjust the sealing rod tension after changing the crucible. You've just seen how simple it is to operate the J2R. Be sure to keep your operation manual handy to refer to if you forget some of the information presented here. If you're experiencing a problem that's not covered by the manual, you can call the NewTek dealer where you purchased your machine. When you need expendable items such as crucibles or stirring rods, contact your dealer or refer to the Rio Grande Tools Catalog for J2R and other casting needs. The rugged components of the J2R have been designed and built for this machine by NewTek. As such, you can expect many years of solid performance from your J2R.